thank you very much for the invitation. And I'm, as presented, Jørgen Brock from Denmark, from the Ministry of Denmark, but I'm first from the ELGPN network. And what I will do today is to talk a little about the process. Now we heard the political aims by Andrea Cannoni, and she told about the problem with youth unemployment and other problems regarding the European Union at the moment. What I will do is talk about the ELGPN network, which is a part also of the project. ELGPN is the European Lifelong Guidance Policy Network, and was established in 2007 and had four, and still have four, priority themes. One of them is what we're here together about, is the career management skills and how to develop career management skills. And the other three priorities in the work of ELGPN is access to guidance, while it has been a very crucial issue also to secure that citizens at all ages have access to guidance in all countries. Some places it has been difficult, and that's what this group is working on. The third group is to improve cooperation and coordination mechanisms in guidance policy. There have been in some countries, more countries now than in the beginning, set up different kind of dialogue forums in the countries in order to have a dialogue on what will, how can you develop career guidance in the countries. And the fourth and the last, and not least important, is to work on quality assurance in order to all the time have the best quality of guidance, career guidance, and also to have evidence base for policy and system development. There is a lot of work done in that group in order to find out how can you develop guidance policies in order to make it more efficient and in order to reduce dropouts, reduce unemployment rates, and some of those political aims which was mentioned by Cannoni before. Lifelong guidance contributes to, as we heard before, which is also included in the EU 2020 strategy, preventing early school leaving, which is a problem in many countries in the EU, to reduce dropout. In many countries, it is a problem that too many young people drop out from school, especially in many places from the VET program, the vocational programs. And one of the aims is also to prevent skill mismatches and to secure that we have the needed skilled labor force for the labor market in the EU countries. And also, it is an important issue to address social equity and social inclusion. And at the end, you could say one of the important issues is to secure growth at societies within the EU Union, and that may be a precondition in order to prevent the dropouts and prevent early school leaving and so on. So there is a connection between the goals. The aim of ELGPN, which is a network, is and also includes the candidate countries, is to help the European Commission in developing European cooperation in lifelong guidance, and it's in both education and labor market sectors. There is a problem often that the labor market and the educational sector are divided. It's necessary to cooperate between those different sectors in order to get the right education for people and in order to have that education also targeted to what are the needs on the labor market. So the connection is very important here. In the beginning, a little history from the ELGPN network. It worked very much with exchanges of knowledge to know what is happening in other countries and experiences related to those four priorities. From the resolution of lifelong guidance, which came in 2000. There was one in 2004, and there was another one in 2008. The next steps was in 2011-12, in the work program, to take account the strategies we heard of before from Cannoni, from the EU 2020 and the European Training 2020 strategies in order to secure that guidance policies is linked to the overall political policies of the EU and can help to implement some of those goals. The latest, which is the working program here for 2013 and 14, has been to deepen the previous work, which was much experience related, to on the four themes, and to examine how lifelong guidance contributes on the different areas to EU policy development in at least those six areas: schools, VET, vocational education and training programs, higher education, adult education, employment, and social inclusion, because they are all very important areas. What we are here together about is CMS in primary school, but to know that there is a connection, you can see from the figure that you have the four priorities: career management skills, access, cooperation, coordination, quality assurance, and evidence base. And it is a work being done in the different branches or the different ages of young people and adult people, people in school, people in employment, and people who have to be social included. So it, you can see this is a picture of the lifelong guidance system where it covers all the necessary areas to be developed further. ELGPN aim 2013-14 has been to promote and assist, like we do in this project, to the adaptation, the field testing, which is very important to have test that it's not only written academics written reports, but it's tested, it's based on evidence, it's based on practice around the countries. And that ELGPN should be a resource center to support that kind of development. Also to provide opportunities for discussions and reflection, which is also a part of this project, to have an ongoing discussion and reflection on what are the main issues within the CMS, which is in this project, and how is this combined to the overall aim of the EU policies. For that purpose, there were organized some review clusters in as part of the ELGPN, and those clusters were four, very similar to what has been the beginning of the ELGPN, but you can see the first one covered all themes to say, when we look at it all together, how can lifelong guidance policies support the overall strategies. It has been, amongst other things, teachers training, how funding is done. That has been some of the discussion in the PRC1, all themes. Then there is the one we are together of here today, the career management skills, which is a very important one. And then you have the two others together, the access and coordination in one group. So there has been countries participating in that group both on access and coordination. And still, quality evidence is one very important group. There has been done a lot of writing, a lot of reporting, a lot of analysis during the ELGPN network period. There's been made different kind of concept notes, policy briefings, internal working papers circulating, and you can access it from the website, the ELGPN website, where you have all the updated reports and working papers. And this is to have it in the open, what is the knowledge, what is evidence at the moment seen from a lifelong guidance perspective. The concept notes examine the relationship of lifelong guidance to youth guarantee initiatives. As we saw before, there is, I think the number was 22.8%, which was the youth unemployment rate in Europe at the moment. So this work about with lifelong guidance is very closely linked to the battle against youth unemployment. early school leaving is also a part of what we saw, the 22.8 rate of unemployment. And the different form of work-based learning is also a crucial issue, because many kids are not ready for school. They leave school, and they leave school early, and you have to find ways also to have work-based learning for young and for adults. Then there have been different kinds of summary reports, where you have had reports summarizing the results from the different working groups, and been linked also to the 2020 working program, in order to all the time have it in progress and have the perspective of helping, supporting the overall goal of the European Union policies. So you can say, that's what I put a smiley below, that there is a connection, luckily, between what is being done in the area of guidance policies and the EU 2020 strategy. Guidance is not just something which some guidance people do in an isolated area. It's very close connected to what is happening and what are the challenges of the European Union at the moment. I think that is very important to keep that in mind all the time when working with guidance policies, that it's not only for guidance practitioners, it's for fulfilling the goals, you could say, the aims of the 2020 strategies of the EU countries. And the role of ELGPN has been to become a focal point and knowledge source for all matters concerned with lifelong learning. And all the member countries are very actively engaged in it. And in that way, you can say it's a very good experience to be a part of the ELGPN network, because there are many people working very hard and very committed to make analysis and finding strategies in ways to support the EU strategies. There's been working a lot about on the developing of methodologies and different experiences in the member countries, because there are very it's a very diverse organization, the EU Union, so you have very different experiences in the different countries, and this is, you can say, an important issue to take into considerations, that even if we have one strategy for EU, we have very different experiences in the countries, which has to be taken into consideration when planning, developing strategies within guidance policies. There has been, as a part of the process, a growing understanding, growing common understanding and recognition of the importance of lifelong guidance due to the very hard work being done by members and working groups in the ELGPN. And the 2008 resolution on lifelong guidance and the progress reports, the resource kit, glossary, evidence guide, you can say, are examples of this cooperation and of this common understanding on where guidance is at the moment in the EU countries. We have this continuous improvement cycle, which is a model for how work is being done, how the process is, where you can see you have in the middle the ELGPN toolbox containing guidelines, resource kit, evidence guide, and so on, which has been translated into not all countries, but many of the countries in the EU have translated the resource kit to the language. And then it's on the national arena being customized and being facilitated in order to implement the overall strategies in the different countries. There's been this clustering and twinning amongst countries. For example, the German-speaking countries have made one cluster in the Nordic area. Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Finland has made sharing twinning organization. And there are other examples of this too. So you have kind of combined clusters within this process. Then you have all the time the reflection, does it work? What are the strategies? What are the plans? When we translate it, when we implement it, what should be changed? What should be reflected on and moved into another circle in order to adjust and improve what is being written at the moment? So it's an ongoing process, you can say, what is going on, where we all the time are learning from our experiences. The results at country level, there are many countries from the report saying that they have had impressive progress in most countries using being a part of this process, and the model from before is a very useful way to, you can say, to run the process in order to all the time have a dynamic process underlying all the working groups. And it provides this process a basis for revision and extension of the toolbox, which is all the time developed. And the toolbox, I think it's a good impression to use, because it is like a toolbox. You can use some of it, but you can't use all of it. And some can use much of it, and other countries can use some other parts of it. And that is how it should be. If you need a hammer, you take the hammer. If you need some other things from the toolbox, you can use that. But it all is within the toolbox, so you can pick it and, so to say, use it in the national context where you are. Yeah, and one of those clusters is the ELGPN, which has focused on the career management skills, and there has been a shift of paradigm in guidance related to career management, which is a shift, you can say, from where guidance is redefined from remedial to preventive guidance, in order to have guidance before, at an early stage, to have an influence on what is happening, and in order also to have a long-term or a longer-term perspective on the individual guidance. So in the process, there has been another, a more dynamic definition, you can say, on what guidance is and what career management is. And as you can see in the papers, there is, just to remember, this definition of career management skills, which is this one, refers to a range of competences which provide structured ways for individuals and groups to gather, analyze, synthesize, and organize self, educational, and occupational information, as well as the skills to make and implement decisions and transition. It's much about decision, taking decisions of what education to have, what labor to have, and also to be able to cope transitions from compulsory school to youth education, transition from youth education to labor market, and so on. It's often in transitions that you have dropouts, that you have early school leaving, and that you have problems in, for instance, entering the labor market after having finished a youth education. So what are the results of the CMS till now? It's a very diverse picture, but that's how, I mean, the cooperation in the EU is. Some countries have developed a national CMS framework, and for both education and employment sectors, and others have such framework under consideration. So they are at different phases. Some countries are very far, and other countries are not so far. I haven't put up the countries on who have reached very fine results and who have not, but from the report, which has just come 2 days ago, 3 days ago, you can see the status, which countries are considered to have developed a framework and which are at the moment not considered to have considered the framework. I have not taken the countries in this presentation. Some other countries have developed a national CMS framework only for educational sector. Some have done it only for schools, primary, secondary schools. Some have done it for the VET, for the vocational educational training program, and other for higher education sector. So it depends on where our guidance focused on in the countries, where focus in some countries much is in the primary and the lower secondary school, whereas it in other countries is very much developed within the employment area or in the VET system. In most countries, CMS-related policies are connected to the overall framework of the sector. Places where CMS-related policies are implemented in more than one sector, most countries have common policy goals, so it's connected with common policy goals. This is not the same as to say that they have the same milestones, strategies, or tools, or cooperation between the sectors or common further implementation steps. For many countries, the period in the last 2 years has been very important in order to progress in developing and also in implementing CMS-rated policies. You can say in this last period, there's been very much focus on implementing because it's good to have the background analysis and research being done, but if you don't implement it in an ongoing process, it would only be an academic thing to have going. In the period also, there has been some relevant new legislation in many countries, including some of this content of the CMS and lifelong guidance policies. Other countries achieved progress in the period with developing national strategies and agreements between governments, between government regions and local entities on lifelong guidance, because it's very diverse picture how it's organized in countries. In some countries, national employment service or the government has a very crucial role, whereas it in other countries is more decentralized, where the responsibility is more local placed. Other places, there have been new general guidelines for school that include also CMS. So you can say in general, the legislation regarding CMS is not specially dedicated to CMS, but it includes a reference always to CMS, which is considered as an important factor. When CMS, and that happens in some countries, are laid down in relevant laws, agendas, and documents in national areas, countries rate that the awareness and the significance and meaning of the new CMS policies and the goals by policymakers as well or neutral. Most countries report that it's difficult, and this is important, I think, to have in mind. It's difficult to keep policymakers at any steering level interested and informed. I mean, there are so many priorities, and when you look on what was said before, you have the big problem with youth unemployment. You have we had the financial crisis in the EU. We have all kinds of labor market mismatch problems. So in the mind of politicians or policymakers, CMS is not what is in the first row. So you have to push on, keep on working, because politicians, so to say, forget the importance of this unless they are confronted with a report saying that this is a very important issue. So I think it's important to continue that work. Then there is a mix of how it's organized, from a very top-down organizing method to a more bottom-up approach. And I've taken two countries and to give you an example of how it is done. In my country, in Denmark, it's a government priority and it's very much top-down organized at the moment. But that's not a negative approach, because it's always at the same time involving stakeholders. Whereas in Norway, our neighbor country, they have so far a bottom-up strategy initiated by an expert group based on the need to first to clarify, discuss, and understand the perspective as a practitioner, seen from a practitioner's point of view, to suggest at the national level what is needed. So you can see there are two ways of doing it, but I think the most common will be a mix of a top-down and a bottom-up strategy in order to have politicians involved in making decisions, and also in order to have the experiences of practice included in what is being the result of it. So the key conclusions till now from the cluster, from this working in this group about career management skills, is that there is a common understanding of the CMS concept. What is career management skills? And I think this is important in order to have a common ground to work on and to cooperate on. There is a customization at national level, so it's not only reports flying around in the EU universe, it's also spread out and customized at national level, which is important. And it has been presented to policymakers, to national fora in different countries, and to stakeholders in order to work further on it. It has been engaging practitioners and experts in local testing of different kinds, and I think this project is also a good example of being how you can test and develop practice within the career management skills, and in this way give feedback to the experiences we all already have. So you can say in general, policy development and implementation has progressed well since the start in 2007, and has very much focused on how it is implemented at the moment, despite diverse hurdles, because of course there are obstacle hurdles, setbacks in it, but it still moves forward. So reaching the key persons at the steering level has been possible, and involving them and other stakeholders too has been possible at all levels, and but it has proved difficult. It's not an easy one. You have to work hard on it all the time. Cooperation is at an early stage still in the countries. But as the last one, and that will be my finishing words, optimism, I think, is a part of the work in progress. And in this matter, this project I see as an example of enthusiasm and optimism in the working process. And as long as we have that, there's very much hope for further development of CMS. So thank you for the word.